want to call your attention to the book of 1 John chapter 4 for our scripture reading tonight. 1 John chapter 4 verse 1. Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Here is an important warning from the Word of God that we are to try the spirits. And we're told in the book of Isaiah, chapter 8 and verse 20, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. In God's word, we have the standard. We have the plumb line. We have the teaching that will show us whether any religious teaching is of God or not. The modern-day tongues movement is spreading throughout Christendom with amazing speed. It is creating perhaps more excitement in the religious world than any movement of the 20th century. Thousands of people of almost every denomination have now made the claim to have spoken in tongues. At the moment, it seems to be the most ecumenical approach that is successful on the church member level. Since now, Pentecostals, Baptists, Presbyterians, Methodists, Lutherans, Episcopalians, and Roman Catholics claim to have had this experience of speaking in tongues, I believe that it's only fair to examine their claims in the light of God's Word and see if it is scriptural or not. The modern-day tongues movement originated in about the year 1900. A man by the name of Charles F. Parham opened the Bethel Bible School in Topeka, Kansas. Under his teaching and ministry, he laid a stress upon the baptism of the Spirit, so-called, and speaking in tongues. And one of the students, a Miss Ains Osmond, was the first one to have this experience about the first year of this school's operation. Soon after, a dozen or more students in this school had the same experience of speaking in tongues. And it wasn't long until in the year 1906, the Azusa Street Assembly was founded in Los Angeles by a man by the name of Seymour, with a heavy emphasis upon, quote, seeking one's Pentecost. The Pentecostal movement has become a powerful religious force in the first half of the 20th century. A number of religious denominations have been formed as a result of this Pentecostal movement, including the Assemblies of God, the Four Square Gospel Churches, the Church of God in Christ, the United Pentecostal, and many other smaller groups. In the main, these groups have been fed with a steady stream of converts from the mainline denominations, including Baptists, as well as almost every group. And in the last half of the 20th century, which we have been in now for some 22, going on 23 years, we have seen a strange and new development in the tongues movement, when it has taken a strange twist of staying within the mainline denominations for at least 10 to 15 to 20 years. We've been hearing reports about people in these various denominations, including Episcopalians, Methodists, and Baptists, and Roman Catholics, speaking in tongues. And these tongues groups, in the main, are staying within the denomination that they are a member of. And through private classes, prayer groups, and home studies, they're spreading their doctrine and making converts among many people. Some of you may or may not be familiar with the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship, for it has chapters in literally hundreds of cities possibly thousands of cities around the world. They have a chapter here in the city of Lubbock. And this organization is working on an interdenominational level to make converts for the charismatic movement, for the tongues movement, that is proving so successful today. Their television programs and publications are paying big dividends in great numbers of people being attracted to these organizations. Deeper Life magazine, which features the ministry and life of Morris Sorello, openly urges Baptists and Catholics and others to stay in their own denominations and spread the tongues experience throughout their churches. In the April 1971 issue of Deeper Life magazine, they feature Pat Boone, singer and movie star, so-called, ministering with Morris Sorello. As you know, Pat Boone was kicked out of his church for his doctrine on tongues and his baptizing people in his swimming pool and some of his other religious activities. But in this particular issue of Deeper Life, I believe Pat Boone's picture occurs at least five times in that edition. Pat Boone is spreading the tongues doctrine across America as he has opportunities to speak before religious groups. This is only a few of the faces of the tongues movement in America today and around the world. Oral Roberts, one of the leading Pentecostals of the 20th century, several years ago joined the United Methodist Church, and he is still propagating his doctrine, but he is doing it within the framework of the United Methodist Church. One of the most amazing developments has been the way that Roman Catholics have been attracted to the tongues movement. The Roman Catholic Church, with its heavy emphasis upon ritual, seems a strange place for the tongues movement to flourish. But back last year, over 12,000 Roman Catholics met from all over the world. They met on the campus of Notre Dame University in the interest of the charismatic movement and the tongues movement. Multiplied thousands of Roman Catholics claim to have received the baptism and to have spoken in tongues, including many priests and nuns. Some of them have testified that they are now better and more devout Roman Catholics as a result of this experience. The tongues movement has gone ecumenical. I quote from Theodore Epp, a world-famous radio preacher, who brings certainly many good messages over the radio. And he says of the ecumenical tongue movement, "The reason I refer to the charismatic movement as a form of ecumenism is that major doctrinal differences are overlooked by those in the movement as long as a person has seemingly experienced the gifts of the Spirit, particularly the baptism of the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues," unquote. Present Truth magazine, November the 20th, 1972, said, "Pentecostalism is doing more than anything else to bring Catholics and Protestants together," unquote. The Catholic Digest quotes Catholic Bishop Alexander Zaleski as saying, quote, "Perhaps our most prudent way to judge the validity of the claims of the Pentecostal movement in the Catholic Church is to observe the effects on those who participate in the prayer meetings. They are attracted to the reading of the Scriptures and to a deeper understanding of their faith. They seem to grow in their attachment to certain established devotional patterns, such as devotion to the real presence and the rosary," unquote. I want to requote a part of that last phrase. That is, these Catholics that have received this experience that he's talking about are making progress, that is, in their devotion to the real presence of Christ, and I'm sure he's talking about the Mass, and then the rosary, the saying or the counting of the beads on the rosary. Well, to strengthen the idea of the ecumenical spirit that's now evident in the tongues movement, an Episcopal priest and an Assembly of God pastor will lead a 3-day charismatic clinic at St. John's Episcopal Church. This headline appeared in the Alaska Daily News. We see articles such as that in our newspaper from time to time right here in the city of Lubbock. In 1972, the Full Gospel Businessmen's Fellowship had their international convention in the city of San Francisco, California. One of the speakers for this gathering was Father Joseph Fulton, pastor of the Blessed Sacrament Catholic Church in Seattle, Washington, who is an active spokesman for the Catholic Pentecostal movement. I quote from the Gospel Witness, a religious paper, a Baptist paper, published in Toronto, Canada. Note the words of a Roman Catholic clergyman of the Chameleon Monastery, Sherbrooke, Quebec, Canada. Quote, now remember, this is a Catholic clergyman, a Catholic priest. Here's what he says, I believe I'm saved as much as you are. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. I was baptized. I'm sincere and I'm dedicated to Christ. So what if I remain a Catholic? Nothing changes. To me, there is no difference between Catholic and Protestant. What counts is that one believes in Jesus Christ as his Savior. When one meets those who have had the Pentecostal experience, whether Catholic or from another Christian church, we unite together. We are one, for there is no difference. It often happens that I go on Sunday evenings to pray in a French Pentecostal church. I first fulfill my obligations as a Christian Roman Catholic by worshiping the Lord in my own church in the morning. Then I go to pray with other Christians. I don't wear my robes, but I do wear my cross and also my ring. This is from the May 3rd issue, 1973, Gospel Witness. The writer of the above article that I just quoted from attended a Pentecostal meeting at this Catholic monastery. And here is what he said about the meeting. He said, the friendly atmosphere sparked by Chameleon Gerarts, that's the priest there, and his helpers, was quite contagious, and newcomers were quickly put at ease. Lively chatter and heavy cigarette smoke dispelled any thought of formality, unquote. Here they, in a cloud of cigarette smoke, get the baptism of the Holy Spirit and speak in tongues, and they are one with all who do such things, so they say. Last August, in the 6th International Conference on Charismatic Renewal of the Catholic Church took place in Grand Rapids, Michigan. 11,500 people participated in this international conference of the Charismatic Renewal of the Roman Catholic Church. The national advisor for the Catholic Charismatic Movement, Auxiliary Bishop Joseph McKinney, told the group, quote, we need Peter. We must love the leadership of the church, even though it were a scoundrel who leads the church. This has happened. It is not the will of Jesus Christ that the charismatic renewal movement result in factionalism, division or alienation from the Catholic Church. We must be one with the Catholic Church, so he will be able to renew the Catholic Church, unquote. And this is from the same Gospel Witness, which also quotes modernist Henry Pitney Van Dusen, a leading modernist of Union Theological Seminary, as saying, And here's what Van Dusen says. The presence of the charismatic Pentecostal movement among us is said to make a new era in the development of Christianity. The new Pentecost will appear to future historians as a true reformation compared to that of the 16th century, from which will spring a third force in the Christian world, Protestant, Catholic, Pentecostal, unquote. The World Council of Churches, the leading exponent of ecumenicalism in the world, the one organization that probably is working harder than any other to promote a one-world church, released a 16-page paper entitled, Can the Pentecostal Movement Renew the Church? This was released by the World Council of Churches in the month of February and was written by Father Emmanuel Sullivan, a Franciscan friar of the Atonement. It says, the ecumenical movement should look at the whole Pentecostal movement as one of the significant signs of a way forward on the journey to rediscovering full visible unity in Christ, unquote. This is definitely talking about the one world church. And it is according to this paper that was written by a Franciscan priest, a friar of the Roman Catholic Church. When I was a boy, a friar was a chicken you was about to put in the skillet, but this is a different kind of friar. According to him, this is the best way for full, visible unity in Christ to be attained by the religious world. I'm saying tonight, frankly and plainly and clearly, and that no one might misunderstand, that above all else, other than the Scriptures themselves, these recent developments in the tongues movement, in the charismatic movement, show us beyond any doubt that it is a false movement, a false system. If Roman Catholic priests and nuns and Roman Catholics were having a real experience with God, they would be led to leave these apostate organizations just as the Bible teaches. The Scriptures tell us in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 17, wherefore come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. But I receive articles such as the one mentioned in the Deeper Life magazine and others that are supposedly published by Protestants urging the Catholics to stay in the Catholic Church and to spread the tongues movement throughout that church. I once again reiterate and restate and emphasize that if people were having a real experience with the Holy Spirit of God, they would be separating from apostasy, and they would not be seeking to use this to further the ecumenical movement and establish the harlot church of Revelation chapter 17. Well, I think that it's time for us to give a little definition of words, since we've been speaking about tongues and about the charismatic movement. There are two or three words that we need to clearly define if we're going to understand what the Bible says as well as what the modern-day tongues people are saying about this movement. Many people have heard about the charismatic movement. I've used that word a number of times already tonight. The word charisma, from which you get the word charismatic, is found 17 times in the Greek New Testament. 17 times the word charisma is found in the Greek New Testament. It is translated gift 15 times, and it is translated free gift 2 times. So all 17 times it is used in connection with a gift. With one exception, it is found only in the epistles of Paul. In Romans 6:23, the word for gift there is the word charisma. The charisma of God is eternal life. The gift of God is eternal life. The word for gift here is charisma. And it is found a number of times in connection with salvation, but is used concerning other gifts that are mentioned or found in the Bible. Paul uses it 5 times in the writing 1 Corinthians chapter 12, where he speaks of the gifts of the Spirit, including the gift of tongues, and he uses the word charisma there as the word for gift. We're hearing much today about the charismatic renewal or the charismatic revival. And what they are really saying is that they are reviving or renewing the gifts that are found in the New Testament, particularly the gift of tongues and in some instances the gift of healing and some of the other gifts that are mentioned in the New Testament. But they usually emphasize tongues and healing above any of the other gifts and ignore most of the other gifts that are mentioned in the Scripture. Now, there is another word that is heard today that few people, I think, understand the meaning of it. We hear about glossolalia, and this is a tongue twister as far as I'm concerned. We hear about this today. And the word also comes from a word that's found in the New Testament. And that word is glossa, G-L-O-S-S-A. And it's found 50 times in the Greek New Testament and is translated tongues in all 50 times. 16 times it refers to the tongue as an organ of the body. One time it refers to the tongues like as a fire on the day of Pentecost. And in the other 33 places, it refers to languages, as for instance in Revelation chapter 10 and verse 11, where the Scripture says, before many peoples and nations and tongues. The glossolalia movement claims to have the power to speak in tongues as on the day of Pentecost. Unknown tongues are not to be found in the Bible at all. Now, lest some of you lose me on that, I repeat it. Unknown tongues are not to be found in the Bible at all. Not one time is unknown tongues to be found. Unknown is printed in italics in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and this means that it was not in the Greek manuscripts at all, but was added by the translators. And this is one advantage, one great advantage that the King James Version has over practically every other version published today. In the King James Version, when the translators felt that they needed to add a word to clarify a passage, they printed it in different print, italics, the letters slanting over. Unfortunately, some of our Bibles, such as the Scofield Bible, is printed in italics, but they are such weak italics that many times you pass over and not notice that it's in italics. And in this particular instance, in 1 Corinthians 14, they do not clarify anything, but rather confuse the subject. Every tongue spoken of in the New Testament was a known language to some race or people that were in existence in New Testament times. There are no instances in the New Testament of a heavenly language, of an unknown language, or a gibberish or jabbering such as some would have you to believe. None of this is found in the New Testament. If we listen to those who are exponents of the tongues movement, you would think that today that the Bible had a great deal to say about this subject. But actually, the Bible has very little to say about the modern-day tongues movement or tongues in New Testament times. Actually, there are only three examples in all of the Bible of anyone speaking in a tongue or a language that they had not previously already known. The first instance is to be found on the day of Pentecost. And I invite your attention to Acts chapter 2 and verse 1, for we're going to get right down and see what the Bible says about this. Acts chapter 2, verse 1, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place." Now let me just stop here for a moment. Pentecost was one day out of every year on the Jewish calendar. It was an annual Jewish feast day that took place 50 days after the Passover. So they couldn't have but one Pentecost a year ever. But anyway, let's go on. "And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, Behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? And how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born?" On the day of Pentecost, the prophecy of John the Baptist that is found in Luke chapter 3 and verse 16 was fulfilled. He, that is John, said, "He, or Christ, shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost." This took place on the day of Pentecost. And in Acts chapter 2, verses 16 to 21, Simon Peter says that this day was also a fulfillment of Joel chapter 2, verses 28 to 32. Something happened on the day of Pentecost that has never happened before and has not happened since that day, not in the same manner as on the day of Pentecost. Devout Jews from many nations were gathered in Jerusalem. These Jews had been born in these various countries of the world. In fact, 16 nations and tongues are mentioned here in verses 9, 10, and 11. Here these names are given: Parthians and Medes and Elamites and the dwellers in Mesopotamia and in Judea and Cappadocia in Pontus in Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia in Egypt, and in the parts of Libya about Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabians. We do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful works of God. Beloved, here are the languages of the day of Pentecost. There was no unknown tongue. Every person that was there, regardless of their ancestral home, whether it was in the land of the Medes or in Cappadocia or Mesopotamia or Italy or wherever they had been born as Jews and had grown up with that being their native language, here in the city of Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost, they heard these Galileans speaking in their own tongue. In tongues on the day of Pentecost. And if you isolate one verse from this text of Scripture, it would indicate that there were many that spoke in tongues. But that is clarified in the context. For the Bible tells us in verse 7, "Behold, are not all those which speak Galileans?" It was only the Galileans who spoke in tongues that they had not previously learned, but which they were endowed to speak in on the day of Pentecost. It's as clear, as plain as it can be. Paul asked the question in the book of Corinthians, "Do all speak in tongues?" where he's speaking of the gifts of the Spirit. There never was an occasion when tongues were used, as is found here, when everyone present spoke in tongues. And we'll have more to say about that as we move along in the message. But let me reemphasize. The Scripture says that only the Galileans spoke. Now, who were the Galileans? You check into it, you'll find that these were the apostles of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. For it was in the region of Galilee where He chose His apostles. Remember on one occasion in Matthew chapter 4 where He chose four fishermen who were Galileans. It was these Galileans that spoke in the tongues on the day of Pentecost. And there is not one verse of Scripture here that says that any of these people prayed to speak in tongues, that they sought to speak in tongues, that they longed to have the gift of tongues. In fact, there is not one verse of Scripture in the Bible, anywhere, any place, that gives us even one example of people seeking the gift of tongues as we hear of people doing today. A few months ago, I was called at long distance by a father who asked me to go and speak with his daughter and son-in-law here in the city of Lubbock. I took Brother Robinson with me, and we went into this home, and we heard the sad story of this woman. She, being a Baptist, had been seeking to speak in tongues. And she told how that she had gone into the park and prayed and prayed and prayed until God gave her the ability to speak in tongues. That's the danger of this thing. There is no Scripture that teaches that anybody ever sought to have this gift. And if one is expecting some kind of a sensational experience and prays for it and asks for it, they are likely to have it. But let me warn you that that experience very likely will not come from God, especially if it is an unscriptural experience. It will come from the wicked one. Tongues served two purposes on the day of Pentecost. They were a sign, first of all, to the Jews who were gathered there at Jerusalem. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 22 that the Jews seek after a sign. Secondly, they serve to communicate with and to evangelize these Jews from the various corners of the Roman Empire who were gathered there for a temporary period in the city of Jerusalem. What better way to reach them with the gospel of Jesus Christ and send them back to their own areas as evangelists, as soul winners, as witnesses from the Lord. And thus we have a supernatural experience on the day of Pentecost that is not being duplicated today. If it were, then, beloved, our missionaries like Brother Robinson and others would not have to slave over the language of some foreigner trying to learn it to stand up and to preach the gospel in that language. Here would be a most practical application of the gift of tongues, but not even the most avid Pentecostals pretend that they are able to go into a foreign land and speak in a language that they have not previously learned so that the people might understand what they said. There was no unknown tongue on the day of Pentecost. I emphasize it. I re-emphasize it. They heard them speak in the language wherein they had been born. This is the clear testimony from Acts chapter 2. And do not allow anyone to confuse you into believing that it was something else. In fact, there is no record that the church at Jerusalem ever had another service like this one. You can search the book of Acts and the New Testament in vain. You'll never find where the Bible says anything about them at the church at Jerusalem ever speaking in tongues again. I'm not saying they didn't, but there is no evidence from the Scripture, and I think it's very likely that they did not ever have this experience in the church at Jerusalem again. 3 years later, about 3.5 years later, down at the house of Cornelius is the next time that you find any mention of speaking in tongues. Cornelius was an unsaved Gentile of the Italian band. He was a centurion of the Roman army. And you remember the story in Acts chapter 10 and verse 34 to 48, where Simon Peter was sent down to the house of Cornelius to preach the gospel to him. And when he preached the gospel, we find that at the very time that he spoke, that the Holy Ghost fell on all them that heard the word. And here, among the Gentiles, which had still, after all these years, been looked down upon by the Jews, and the Jews actually doubted whether God could or would save the Gentiles, even though in the Great Commission they were told to carry the gospel to every creature. And yet, down at the house of Cornelius, we find that Cornelius and others of his household received the gift of the Holy Ghost and began to speak with tongues and magnify God, is what the Bible says in Acts chapter 10. They did not pray for, they did not ask for, they did not seek the gift of tongues. At least if they did, there's not one word in the Scripture that would indicate so. It is very likely that they had not even heard of the gift of tongues ever having taken place before. This event represented a sign also, a sign to the Jews that these seven Jews, and by the way, there were seven, because there was Simon Peter and six other brethren. We're taught this in Acts chapter 11 and verse 12, that went with him down to the house of Cornelius. And it was a sign to them that God not only could save the Gentiles, but that the Lord could fill them with the Holy Spirit also, and God could use them. In fact, in the three instances of speaking in tongues in the New Testament, there are no instances where anyone ever spake in tongues without there being Jews present. It was a sign to the unbelieving Jews on the day of Pentecost at the house of Cornelius. It was a sign to the believing Jews that they who were gathered there with Simon Peter, that they might go back and convince the church at Jerusalem that the Gentiles should be evangelized. They did not call this a Gentile Pentecost. It would have been a mockery to have done so, because it didn't take place on the one day out of the year which was known as the day of Pentecost. And to call it a Pentecost experience is certainly a misrepresentation of the Word of God. It was not until 22 years later, down in the city of Ephesus, in Acts chapter 9, verses 1 to 7, did we hear anything about anyone speaking in tongues. 12 men in the city of Ephesus claimed to be disciples and to have received the baptism of John the Baptist. But when Paul met them, he asked them this question: "Have you received the Holy Ghost since ye believe?" Literally, he is asking, "Did you receive the Holy Ghost when you believe?" This is the question. And you know what their answer was? They said, we have not so much as heard whether there be an Holy Ghost or any Holy Ghost. In other words, they had not even heard of the person of the Holy Spirit of God. This proves that they knew little or nothing about John the Baptist preaching, because John the Baptist not only preached Jesus, but he preached the Holy Ghost. These people had been discipled by someone who did not know the full gospel story, and thus they had not come to the knowledge of salvation. The Apostle Paul preached to them the Lord Jesus, and they believed. And the Bible tells us that he laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. Here again, it does not say that they prayed to speak in tongues or that they sought to speak in tongues. And once again, it was a sign to these Jews who were there in the city of Ephesus that God was moving in that direction also. If there are only three instances of speaking in tongues in the New Testament, why are they not mentioned elsewhere in the New Testament? Well, I believe there is a definite reason for this. At the time that the book of Acts was written, we just have the historical record of these three instances. Even though there are many instances of Paul's preaching in the cities of Asia Minor, in the cities of Greece, and in other cities of Europe, there is no mention of any services where they had this kind of an experience of speaking in tongues. In fact, there is not any other instance of speaking in tongues mentioned in the Bible except in the abuse of tongues that's found in the book of 1 Corinthians, and we'll deal with that in a moment. But at the time that the book of Acts transpired, the events that took place here, there were possibly only four books that had been written, and we're not certain that all four of these had been written. Certainly they had not been widely circulated at this early date in 57 A.D. Matthew, Mark, and 1st and 2nd Thessalonians were likely the only four books that were in circulation at that time, if they were. Acts was written in 65 A.D., and it only mentions tongues three times. Romans, 2 Corinthians, and Galatians were written in 60 A.D., and there's no mention of the gift of tongues. Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians were written in 64 A.D., and there's no mention of tongues. 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus were written at an unknown date, but there is no mention of tongues. Philemon was written in 64 A.D., and Hebrews in 70 A.D., James in 62 A.D., 1 Peter in 60 A.D., and 2 Peter in 66 A.D., and there's no mention of tongues in them. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John were written in 90 A.D., Jude in 60 A.D., or 66 A.D., and Revelation in 96 A.D., and none of these mention the gift of tongues. It seems incredible if tongues were to continue in this dispensation, in this age of grace, that these epistles, these letters, these books that teach the doctrines of the Word of God, the doctrines and the practice of the church, that they would not mention the gift of tongues if it was to be an everyday experience in the age of grace. I believe that this is convincing proof that the gift of tongues was not included in the permanent gifts to the Christians and to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. To see the importance of tongues, we need to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 to 11. 1 Corinthians 12, 8 to 11. Here the Bible says, for to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing. And here again is that word charisma, the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. To another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another divers kinds of tongues, and another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. Now there are those today who are teaching that you have to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and to speak in unknown tongues, or you're not a Christian. The Bible says even here in the day when tongues were operating in the New Testament, that the Spirit distributed these gifts. Not all received the same gift. Not all received the gift of tongues. In verse 30 of this same chapter, he said, "Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret?" And the answer is obviously no, because it was known then that they did not all do this, and Paul knew it also. You note in this list of gifts of the Spirit that we just read in verses 8 to 11, that tongues and the interpretation of tongues is put at the very bottom of the list. Also in verses 28 to 30, you see these gifts mentioned here, and once again in verse 28, you find that diversities of tongues is put at the very end of the list. And I believe that these are in order of importance, as you can see in verse 27, or verse 28, when he says, "Set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers." He's listing them in the order of importance, and tongues is put at the very end of the list. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 8 to 12, you have the gifts of the Spirit once again. But remember that Ephesians were written years later, and here in this list, tongues is not found at all. Also, some of the gifts of God are mentioned in Romans chapter 12, verses 4 to 8, which you'll not take time to turn and read tonight, but tongues are missing from that list also, written years later. And even the fruit of the Spirit that's listed in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, tongues is not listed as being the fruit of the Spirit. Even in 1 Corinthians 12, where tongues are included, they're at the bottom of both lists, and I believe show, even in that day, their importance in the plan of God. But I must hasten on to the ceasing of tongues. I want to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, beginning with verse 8. Charity. The word charity here is in the Greek love. And I'm going to read it thusly here. "Love never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three. But the greatest of these is charity." Here some words need to be explained in this text of Scripture. He says, "Whether there be prophecies, they shall fail." Verse 8. Prophecies here has to do with the office of the prophet, who received a revelation directly from God of the future. And when the Scripture says that prophecy shall fail, this does not mean that any prophecies that were ever given by divine inspiration shall fail to come to pass. This is not the meaning at all. Literally, the word "fail" here means that it will be superseded by something else. "Whether there be prophecies, they shall fail." The why? Because when the prophecies of God's Word were completed, and they were completed, we know, by year 96 A.D., for that is approximately the date that John wrote the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, on the Isle of Patmos. When that was finished, there was no more need of writing down any prophecies. That is the reason why that prophecies shall fail. And then He speaks of knowledge vanishing away in that same verse. Knowledge here means revelatory knowledge, or knowledge that is revealed by divine inspiration. Not all of the inspired Word of God is prophecy. Some of it is just the inspired knowledge that God has given through His prophets to write down. It is all the Word of God, but not all of it is prophecy. When knowledge was finished, vanished away when the New Testament was completed. And in this same verse He said, tongues shall cease. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Here, tongues means the gift of tongues, not just languages. I'm speaking in a tongue tonight. It's supposed to be the English tongue. I may not speak it well, but I'm speaking in that tongue. All of you here, as far as I know, understand the English language. But whether there be tongues, they shall cease. He's talking about the gift of tongues, whereby people on these rare occasions could speak in a language that they had never learned. Oh, listen. If the tongues had not ceased, then what wonders we would see today as men went to the mission field to preach. Well, I know that God in His divine wisdom has chosen the best way. And He said, tongues shall cease. And they have. Why? Because now we have the completed Word of God. Look at verse 9. He says, for we know in part. This is the knowledge which was just in part that He's been writing about in verse 8. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. He says, now we know in part, and we prophesy in part. Here is the prophecy and the knowledge that is revealed in verse 8. Remember when Paul wrote this message to the Corinthian church was about 57 A.D., and they didn't have the New Testament. But after the last book of the Bible had been finished, then there was no need for tongues to continue. I'm not sure that they even continued until the last book of the Bible was finished. But the Bible definitely says that tongues shall cease. And in the 20th century, we have seen people trying to restore something that God caused to cease. It's not that God couldn't. He could make every one of us here tonight speak in an unknown tongue if He so desired. He has that power. But He has already said that tongues shall cease. And so God is not going to contradict His Word tonight. God doesn't contradict His Word. Men may contradict their own Word, and they may contradict the Word of God, but God does not contradict His Word. Now then, He says, but in verse 10, but when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. Now some say that the perfect here is talking about Christ and His coming. But this is not true. Perfect here does not refer to Christ. Christ always has been perfect. But He says, when that which is perfect is come. And this is an adjective that's used as a noun here, and it's in the neuter gender. Therefore, it has reference to the finished or perfect or complete Word of God. If it referred to Christ, it would be in the masculine gender. It wouldn't be in the neuter gender. And so, therefore, this passage of Scripture is talking about the complete Bible when that which is perfect is come. We are told in 2 Peter chapter 1 that we have a more sure word of prophecy that we do well, that we take heed to as a light that shineth in a dark place until the day star shall arise in our heart. What is that more sure word of prophecy? It's this blessed book, this blessed Word of God. We have a more sure word of prophecy that we take heed of as a light that shineth in a dark place. The Word of God is completed. We don't need anyone to write another book to be added to the Bible. We do not need anyone to give us a new revelation from God, because God has completed His book, and it's His message to man today. When the New Testament was completed, tongues and knowledge and prophecy were no longer needed. And beloved, I believe with all of my heart that they ceased long ago. But remember in 1 Corinthians 14 that Paul gives the regulation for the usage of tongues. And while I do not have time to deal with this at length, I can only touch upon it tonight. But tongues had not ceased when Paul wrote to the church at Corinth. They had abused tongues. In fact, they abused most everything they ever did. This was the church that got drunk at the Lord's table, eating the Lord's supper. They made it into a big banquet, a big feast, and they brought in their intoxicating drink, and they got drunk there. And so that we can't go by the example that this church set. But here we find that Paul set down some very strict rules to regulate the use of tongues. I say that tongues have ceased, definitely. But they had not ceased when Paul wrote this. Therefore, the church at Corinth needed to be regulated in connection with the use of tongues. And they were already abusing tongues, and Paul was correcting them on this point. Now then, if we look in 1 Corinthians 14, Paul gives these rules. And yet the modern-day tongues movement violates almost every one of these rules set down. And yet they say that God is causing them to do this. Now you listen to me tonight. God is not going to cause anybody to contradict the teaching of His Word. We repeat, tongues have ceased as a gift. However, if they were in effect today, these same rules which applied to the church at Corinth would apply to those who would be using them today. In verses 1 through 6, Paul seeks to show these Corinthians that prophecy was more edifying than the use of tongues. And he emphasizes this very strongly in 1 Corinthians 14, the first 6 verses. Secondly, he taught them that an uncertain sound, whether it be the uncertain sound of a trumpet in a battle, or whether it be the uncertain sound of a tongue that was not understood, would not lead anyone in the right direction. In verses 7 to 17, he clearly sets forth the need of speaking in words that could be understood. In verse 19, he says that 5 words that can be understood are better than 10,000 words in an unknown or a tongue that could not be understood. You listen to me tonight. I've sat in the services down in Mexico when a Mexican stood to preach, and I couldn't understand anything that he said. It didn't edify me. It didn't build me up. On the other hand, I've been in services here in the States where people supposedly were speaking in tongues, and it didn't edify me either. And I'll tell you, there's a world of difference, though, because these people that are preaching in Spanish, and that's their language, at least they can understand it, and you can rejoice in that. But when there is just a bunch of gibberish and just a bunch of people all hollering and yelling at the same time, that doesn't edify, that doesn't teach anyone. Tongues were for a sign to the Jews, and they were to the unbeliever something that could not be understood, and they were not for the enjoyment of the believer, according to verse 22. Gibberish flowing from the mouth only confused the unlearned and turned them from the truth, according to verse 23. If therefore the whole church be come together into one place and all speak with tongues, and there come in those that are unlearned or unbelievers, will they not say that you're mad? Yes, I know that Paul knew what he was talking about. This kind of a service doesn't glorify God. It didn't then, and it doesn't today. Please look at verse 27. If any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two, or at the most by three, and that by course, and let one interpret. Do you understand what this means? This means that no more than three people could speak in one service in a tongue. In other words, it was limited to two or three at the most, and these were not to speak all at the same time, but rather in course or in order, that is, one at a time. And yet we find that the modern day tongues movement ignores this teaching of the Scripture, and generally they speak, many of them, at the same time. This passage of Scripture also tells us in the next verse, if there was no interpreter present, then let him keep silence in the church. In other words, if there was not someone present who could interpret every word that was spoken in this tongue or language so that every person in the audience could understand what was being said, then the Bible tells us that they were to keep silence. They didn't have the right, they didn't have the responsibility or the opportunity for, as far as God is concerned, to go on and speak in a tongue. Then if you'll notice in verse 33, the Bible teaches here that there was to be no confusion in the service. For the Scripture says God is not the author of confusion. But I believe that confusion today best describes many of the modern day tongue meetings when they speak in tongues. There is a confusion throughout the audience as people raise their hands and as they begin to jabber and to make a noise that unsaved people cannot understand, and even the saved people there do not know what is going on. Then we find in verse 34 that the Scripture says, let your women keep silence in the church, for it's not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. Here the Bible clearly and plainly says that the women were not to speak in either in their own native language or in a tongue in the services of the church. This forbids women speaking in tongues. It is a well-known fact that in most of the tongue services there is a predominance of women today who are supposedly speaking in a tongue. This is contrary to the teaching of the Scriptures. This is forbidden by God Himself. The Bible says that the woman is to be in subjection. There is not one verse of Scripture in the whole New Testament that indicates that any woman ever spoke in a tongue which many people call an unknown tongue today. The Bible simply does not sanction it. The Bible does not permit it. And so this shows to us and reveals to us that this movement today is false and is not of God. In verse 40, the Bible says, let all things be done decently and in order. And yet I tell you that most of the tongue services are not decently and in order. I myself have observed people while under the power of one of these tongue services to do things that were indecent, things that they would have not have done under ordinary circumstances. I repeat that tongues have ceased according to the Bible. But if tongues had not ceased, then I submit to you that every one of these conditions laid down in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 would be enforced today. They were in force in the day that Paul wrote this letter to the Corinthians, for tongues had not yet ceased at that particular time. But they have ceased today, and they certainly do not give us the regulations for tongues today, because the Bible does not teach that we're to have tongues today. If tongues are so unscriptural, why is there so much emphasis on this subject today? There's several possible sources for tongues. The first source would be a divine source. We've already ruled this out because tongues are contrary to the teaching of the Scripture. The second source would be satanic. The third source would be psychological. And the fourth source, fakery. We believe that every tongues experience today is one of the last three listed. It's either satanic or psychological, or it's out-and-out fakery. Why and where do tongues flourish in this 20th century that you and I are living in? First, they flourish where the Bible is not taught or where the Bible is not understood. People who have matured in the faith of God's Word, who really understand the doctrines of grace, who really understand what the Bible teaches, will not fall for the fakery of the tongues movement. Secondly, where people are seeking some experience, either a vision or a feeling, rather than the truth of the Bible, is a place where tongues flourish today. They also flourish among people who have been exposed to the cold, dead preaching of modernistic churches. And somehow they are tired of all of the coldness and the deadness of their church. And someone invites them to one of these tongue-speaking churches or to a meeting where there is an emphasis upon this. And because of the warmth and because of the fervor there, they fall for this, thinking that it is of God. And also tongues flourish where orthodoxy has become dead and cold, and where the Spirit of God is not moving in the midst of His people. And tongues also flourish among the lost, who are seeking a religious experience rather than seeking the Lord Jesus Christ. In fact, to seek after any experience that is contrary to the teaching of God's Word is one of the most dangerous things that a person can do today. Why? Because they lay themselves wide open for demonic invasion and delusion. Will you listen to this verse of Scripture from 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1? In the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Here is a warning from the inspired pen of the Apostle Paul, warning us that in the last days there would be people who would depart from the faith, who would give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And beloved, I believe that we're living in that day right now. You know, Satan is an imitator. He's been imitating God down through the centuries of time. Everything that God has ever done, Satan has tried to imitate it and is still trying to imitate it. We're told in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 11 that it is definitely taught that there are false apostles. There are deceitful workers transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. Here the Bible warns us of Satan, who goes about as an angel of light. Here the Bible warns us that he has his apostles, his deceitful workers, who pretend that they are these workers of Christ, the preachers of Christ, and they are really doing the bidding of Satan. That is the reason why that in our text tonight we are warned in the Bible to try the spirits, to see whether they be of God or whether they be of man. And we're told how we are to try them in Isaiah 8 and verse 20, that here we are definitely taught that if they speak not according to the words of this prophecy, it is because there is no truth in them. Beloved, we do not need some new supernatural experience. We have the revelation of God's Word. We have these 66 books of the Holy Bible, and we dare not seek after some experience that God has already said in His Word has ended, has ceased. Because if we begin seeking for something like this, some certain feeling, some experience where we can jabber in a celestial language so-called, then Satan will give us that experience and people will be blinded and led down the road to hell. There is no need today to seek the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The Bible teaches us very clearly and very plainly that every born-again believer already has the Holy Spirit dwelling within them. They already have the Spirit of God, and they do not need to seek Him who is already dwelling within them. Listen to the Bible in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 And in verse 9, what know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which is you have of God, and you're not your own, for you're bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Here the Bible says that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. He doesn't say, seek to make it the temple of the Holy Ghost. If you're saved, your body is already the dwelling place of the Holy Ghost of God here upon this earth. And it is mockery, it is foolishness to ask and to beg and to plead for the coming of the Holy Spirit, who has already come and regenerated you and dwells within you as a child of God. We're also told in Romans the 8th chapter and the 9th verse, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Then the Holy Spirit is dwelling within the believer. Yes, we need to be filled with the Spirit according to the Word of God. This does not mean bringing the Holy Spirit from heaven down to us, but rather cleaning up our lives and surrendering our life, that the Spirit who already dwells within us might fill every room of our life for the honor and the glory of God. There is no need for tarrying. There is no need for seeking or begging for the Holy Spirit to come. The Holy Spirit is received by simple childlike faith when a person believes and trusts in Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Then the Holy Spirit moves within that heart and within that life. And if we want to be constantly filled with the Spirit of God, all we need to do is to surrender and yield our lives to the indwelling Spirit of God who lives and abides within us. Shall we stand with heads bowed?